Good morning and welcome to Ebenezer Mennonite Church's online English service this morning. In a world where people are shouting their opinions, we need the Bible's guidance to speak truth wisely. To that end, Pastor Reese will be preaching on speaking out wisely from the book of Daniel chapter 1. We'll start our time together with prayer and worship. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving us the wisdom to discern the truth of your word regarding our relationships with others in this challenging time, where people are not always listening to one another, but are trying to get their own opinions across. Help us to be wise, gentle, and committed to your truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Philippians 4:4-8. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, for in every situation, by petition and prayer, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent and praiseworthy, think about such things.
Well, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like. I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never wrong. I'm your good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are. answers only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. Perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Love so undeniable. Tender whisper of love in the dead of night.
Welcome, brothers and sisters and visitors. In 1884, an amendment was made to the Indian Act, and it made attendance at a day, industrial, or residential school compulsory for First Nations children. That change, that system that was implemented, endured for over 100 years. The last residential school was closed in 1996. And during that time, about 150,000 First Nations children passed through the system, at least 4,000 of them dying while attending that school. They died at the school. Now, with 2020 hindsight vision, we look back, and the general consensus of our time is that residential schools were not a good thing. They did significant harm to Aboriginal children. It removed them from their families. It took their language from them, gave them English names, took their names. Many of them experienced sterilization, and many, many of them were exposed to physical and sexual abuse at the hands of staff and other students. And we look back on this, we say, that's brainwashing. That's a bad thing. Anytime we see that kind of manipulation by the state for the interest of the state, we start to feel very, very uncomfortable. We know that it's wrong. You should be able to trust your government. You should be able to be hopeful that they have your best interests at heart. Now, today, we listen to a spectrum of opinion out there and hear the idea that government is again seeking to control and change its citizens, or that everything is going great, or that it's horrible, or that they're the devil, or they're our saviors. Now, whether these accusations and the ideas are true or false by varying degrees, how should Christians respond? How do we respond when we feel like we're being controlled, or when we even think that there is an actual agenda of brainwashing in play? Well, we are so blessed that the Bible clearly addresses this. And for that, we have to go to the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 1, verse 1. It starts like this. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. So just to give you a little bit of historical background here, the Jewish king Jehoiakim, he is the brother to the previous king, who was kicked off the throne when the Egyptian pharaoh came in and conquered them and basically put the brother on the throne. Now you're going to be grateful to me, and you're going to be this vassal state. You're going to do what I tell you to do, and you're going to send me lots of money, or else. That's the deal. So when Babylon then, a superpower, attacks Egypt, a superpower, and defeats it, Judah automatically becomes part of the Babylonian Empire. But Judah rebels. So Babylon comes and takes it and beats it up. And the Bible is clear that God allows this. This is actually a part of God's overarching plan. God hands Judah over to Babylon in response to their centuries of idolatry and ignoring their covenant, breaking their covenant with God. And even the temple itself is just sacked and looted. And all of the holy objects from the temple are taken, and they are placed in the treasury of Bel, the Babylonian god, the Babylonian patron god. But it's not just objects that are taken and tribute that is taken. Verse 3. Then the king commanded Ashpenaz, his chief eunuch, to bring some of the people of Israel, both of the royal family and of the nobility, youths without blemish, of good appearance and skillful in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, understanding, learning, competent to stand in the king's palace, and to teach them the literature and the language of the Chaldeans. The king assigned them a daily portion of the food that the king ate and of the wine that he drank, and they were to be educated for 3 years, and at the end of that time, they were to stand before the king. Among these were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, of the tribe of Judah. And the chief of the eunuchs gave them names. Daniel he called Belshazzar, Hananiah he called Shadrach, Mishael he called Meshach, and Azariah he called Abednego. Now let's take a step back from the text for a second. These young people are taken away from their home, and then they're taken away from their families. The king wants raw talent from among the exiles. He wants things that are going to be good for the future of the country as he sees it. And so he wants them retrained. He wants them rewired socially, intellectually, religiously. He wants to reprogram them. And he pulls them out of the slum conditions that they were in when they were first brought into exile. So they were living in nice places in Judah. They're taken out and put into this housing in a not so nice area. Then they're rescued from that by the government, who is now going to control them. And the Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian king, sets Ashpenaz over them. He himself is an object of this brainwashing. He's one of the king's eunuchs. He has nothing to live for but the king. And this is the guy that's put in charge now of these young men. And he renames them. It's an act of dominance, of control. He takes Daniel, and that Daniel's name means God's judge, or God will show what is right and wrong. That's what judging is. And he changes his name to Belshazzar, which means Bel's prince. He basically takes his ownership away by taking his name away. That's the idea, right? Hananiah means God's gift. Shadrach means inspired by the Babylonian sun god. Mishael means who is like God. Meshach means belongs to Shishak. Azariah means God is my helper. Abednego means servant of Nego. So just takes them out of their homes and is going to rewire them and renames them and gives them names that every time they're called, it reminds them they now belong to Babylon. They're property of Babylon. What's good for Babylon is what's going to happen to them, right? Now, verse 8. But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Therefore, he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. Now, we're going to step back from this for a second, too. Daniel resolved. He saw something. He judged right and wrong. Remember, that's what his name means, God's judge. And he knew that it wasn't okay. That if he did it, even though he was encouraged to do it, he would be defiling himself. Even though everyone was saying it's a good thing to do, it will make you better, he saw the truth that it was going to make him worse, that it was going to make him unclean. So he resolved to not do it. He thought, he discerned, then he acted. So the food that's set before them, it's not okay according to Mosaic law. It's not kosher. It's not prepared the way that the Hebrew people were supposed to prepare food. One of the things that made them stand out as God's people. We see that Deuteronomy chapter 6, 4 to 9, right? And it was probably food that was sacrificed to idols first. And so Daniel resolves not to eat Bel's food, which is an ironic action from Bel's prince, Remember, brainwashing, everything around them. Babylon, Babylon, Babylon's gods, up with Babylon. And so somehow this young man, who by the description is in his early teens, if not younger, he's able to remember his upbringing, who he really is, and to resolve not to defile himself. And so he goes to the chief of the eunuchs. It says he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. Look at all the power words that are going here. He doesn't have power, so he goes and he asks. That's all he can do, but he does ask. He goes to the one who does have power over him, and he states it. I do not want to defile myself with this food. He makes his case. He reasons with the eunuch. Let's see what happens in verse 9. And God gave Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the chief of the eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who assigned your food and your drink, for why should he see that you were in worse condition than the youths who are of your own age? So you would endanger my head with the king. Hey, he believes. He believes what Babylon is saying. This is the way to go. This is the best way. If I don't do what's best as far as the king of Babylon says it, I'm making a foolish choice. So we see the worldviews coming face to face. Daniel says, I will be defiling myself, worsening myself if I do this. Ashpenaz is sure it's the right thing to do. If you don't do it, it will be bad for you. And yet he's conflicted. Ashpenaz is conflicted because God has swayed the overseer's heart. A little bit like how Joseph in the book of Genesis again and again enjoys the favor of those he works for. But he's in a tough place, this Ashpenaz. He has direct orders from the king. And to reject the food was to reject a gift from the king's hand. And it was a good gift, right? Wasn't it? Wine and meat, they're the diet of the upper class. This is good eating. And it's what the king wants. It's what's good for Babylon. I don't know if I can take this risk. Verse 11. Then Daniel said to the steward, whom the chief of the eunuchs had assigned over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then let our appearance and the appearance of the youths who eat the king's food be observed by you, and deal with your servants according to what you see. So he listened to them in this matter and tested them for 10 days. Now, before we get confused here, a new person has entered into the equation. Daniel wasn't really getting any traction talking proof of concept with Ashpenaz, the guy in charge. So he talks to the guy who's actually directly in charge of them, and he comes up with a 10-day trial, which is a pretty safe thing. They've got the span of 3 years here. Give us a 10-day trial, steward, person who is directly responsible, person who will actually see what's going on, the correlation between me eating the food of my God, which will not defile me, and everybody else who's eating the food of Bel. And look for yourself. Look for yourself and see if things are not better. That's what he asks him for, right? Then if it works, then they go back to Ashpenaz and see, here is the evidence. This worldview you had, that Bel's way, that Babylon's way is better, here's the actual evidence that it's not, right? So we should not see this as Daniel defying Ashpenaz, but he is walking in alignment with God. He doesn't tell off Ashpenaz. He doesn't have the power to get away with these things. So he goes and asks for a very reasonable, very clever trial run with the person who is directly responsible for overseeing his health. Remember, the goal is his health. So he found a thing that everybody had in common. These young men were supposed to be healthy. They're supposed to be doing better. God gave Daniel the wisdom to not fight a weird fight of Bel versus Yahweh God, which wouldn't have ended well, because right then everyone gets all, like, you know, really upset and indignant and set in their feet are set. And now they're going to fight up and stick up for their God. No, no, he says, well, if the goal is the health of everybody, let's do a 10-day trial with the guy who's actually directly responsible for this sort of thing. And you know what? The steward sees the wisdom of this. If nothing else, then it will, you know, settle down these young Jewish guys. Verse 15. At the end of 10 days, it was seen that they were in better appearance and fatter in flesh than all the youths who ate the king's food. So the steward took away their food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables. Hey, the trial was a success. The steward removed this temptation from them permanently. Remember, the steward's job was the health of the people. That's what he was responsible to Ashpenaz for. That's what Ashpenaz was responsible to the king for. Layers of government. Now, this isn't saying that the steward took food and drink away from all the students. He simply did it for Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. That's what he did. That's what was the request. They weren't fighting for everybody. They were fighting for themselves, that they would not have to defile themselves. They weren't trying to control things. They weren't trying to change the system. They weren't trying to take down the leaders. They just wanted the freedom to be faithful themselves. Okay? Now, verse 17. As for these four youth, God gave them learning and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. And at the end of the time, when the king had commanded that they should be brought in, the chief of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And the king spoke with them. And among all of them, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore, they stood before the king. And in every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters that were in all his kingdom. And Daniel was there until the first year of King Cyrus. God gave these four young men, he blessed them with skills that their instructors were looking for. They passed the king test with flying colors. They were even superior to their instructors, to all the veterans, to all the people that they were being compared to. Those who told the future by singing and enchantments. Those who told the future by reading stars. The ability to tell the future, to interpret dreams, was paramount to military and royal interests, to making sure that an assassin isn't coming for the king. So they are taken seriously. And they didn't have to defile themselves to do it. The good of the country, the good of the king, turned out maybe the king didn't know what was best. He only knew what was normal for him. And so he acted in the light that he had. So be it. That's what people do. But it wasn't on him what Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were going to do. It was up to them. They had to resolve to do what was right. And they needed to be clever. And they needed to be humble. And they needed to be focused. And that's what they were. Now we can summarize what we're seeing here very, very straightforward. We, like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, we need to think. We need to discern what's going on around us, what's going on in us. And we need to think about who God has called us to be and what God has called us to do. These four young men were able to stand because they took seriously the lessons they had learned from their parents, teachers, and mentors growing up. Because remember, at this point, those people are all gone. The only influences around them, all the control around them, it's not about their best interest. There's an agenda. There's brainwashing going on. So they had to think and remember. They had to remember the people who came before them. They'd remember the lessons from scripture, the lessons from their parents, from their teachers. And that gave them a sense of who they were and what they were supposed to do. They had identity and they had purpose. Who they were inside and what they were supposed to do outside. They needed to think about that. They needed to understand that. They needed to judge it and see the difference between God's way and Bel's way. The way of God's people and the Babylonian way. So we need to think just like them. We have to have our eyes open. We have to be intelligent. And here's the second thing we see them do. We need to resolve. We need to resolve just like they resolved, not to defile themselves. Even if everybody else is doing something and everyone is so sure it is right, if we can think and see it is not God's way, we too must resolve not to defile ourselves, to continue the trajectory of the faithful who went before us. Now we will be the faithful and we will do so for our children. People who compromise with the world for the sake of their children do not understand what it is that they are actually doing. They are blowing it, providing people with comfort and wealth and an easy time, but throwing truth away is no way to raise a child, certainly not to raise up a child in the way they should go. We're simply teaching them the path of least resistance is what you should do. So we need to reject that. We need to resolve also to reject the temptation to bitterness and self-pity that makes us act so angry and defiant in people. We need to be very careful about that. We need to act in ways in alignment with our goal because truth is confident and humble. Look how Daniel and his friends acted. They were humble. They were, you could use the word submissive. They said, sir. They went and made requests. They used the system that they were in. They weren't defiant about the system. They just stood with truth. They stood with truth. And they went to the right people and asked the right questions. And one of the things that they had is they had confidence that God's way was actually better. So saying for a trial, let's try God's way. How about we try God's way instead? That was very clever and very true and very humble. And it worked. They didn't do a protest. They didn't try to get Ashpenaz fired. They didn't try to plan a military coup. Now, mind you, they're kids. But the point is that they were able to overcome a lot of other temptations in order to follow God. And you know what? The system around them stood. It continued on. The Babylonian Empire continued on. They were just now inside of it and able to influence it incredibly. Incredibly. So we need to think. We need to resolve. And now we need to act. At some point, we will need to speak out. But how? We see that this is done many ways in our time, often in ways that antagonize others and polarize conversations. But Daniel is consistently bold and humble at the same time. So when he acts in alignment with God's character and nature. He said what he needed to say, and he thought about who he was talking to, and he spoke their language, and he appealed to them. He reasoned with people. He invited and he compelled, but he did not control or manipulate. Goodness, we see that in Jesus. That's how Jesus showed us we as followers are supposed to be. Daniel is an excellent follower of Jesus, even though chronologically he lives on this planet physically before Jesus did. Daniel was never needlessly defiant. He was not signaling to his buddies that they were against the powers that be, that they were against the man, the system. He doesn't bother doing it. He just broke it down to the relationship that he had with the person he was talking to. And then he humbly spoke truth. Oh, that you and I could be so clever and so wise. And with the Holy Spirit in us, we can. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, this wisdom that you have poured out on us. You are there, ready to lead us into this kind of cleverness, this kind of relational honesty, maybe this kind of effectiveness. And yet, Father, we are so tempted by how the world does things. Sometimes we correctly identify truth and resolve to follow it, but then we fight with the world's weapons and we just betray everything that you were trying to show the world through us. Give us the wisdom to follow you. Holy Spirit, have your way in us, not only in what we do, but the way we do it. We thank you for the examples of Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, and that someday we will be with them and see them in heaven, and we will be with others heroes of faith. Let us, Father, somehow be heroes of faith too, following you through the power and work of your Holy Spirit in our lives. We pray this in your name. Amen.
If you say go, we will go. If you say wait, we will wait. If you say step out on the water, and they say it can't be done, we will fix our eyes on you, and we will come. If you say go, we will go. Say wait, we will wait. If you say step out on the water, and they say it can be done, we will fix our eyes on you, and we will come.
Your ways are higher than our ways, and the plans that you have laid are good and true. If you call us to the fire, you will not withdraw your hand. We will gaze into the flames and look for you. If you say go, we will go. If you say wait, we will wait. Good and true. If you
be done. We will fix our eyes on you and we will come. We will fix our eyes on you and we will come.
And now receive this benediction from 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Now go in that peace.
No, not by might. No. Speed.